Hey, Carp Anglers, James Sanders here, and
Thomas Pearson. How you guys doing tonight?
Great. We was going to have a host here, Ricky Massey.
Is that right?
You should get another medallion.
I should. He was going to be here, but he couldn't make it today. So Ricky's going to probably be on our show lots of times, hosting if you can. Sometimes you have a busy schedule like we do. But, you know, it just makes it more interesting when you have, like, three different views on different topics. And plus, you know, and that's more questions for the guests. So, our next guest, what is Rick?
Richie Eldridge.
Yes. A.K.A. the Iceman.
We gave him that nickname a few
years
ago.
We did give him that nickname. Yeah, last time he was on our show was a couple years ago. But before we get all wrapped up in that mess, let's talk about I want to thank everybody who did show up to the Carp Expo 2024. We really appreciate it. It was a good event. New building. Things worked out. I think a lot of people were happy. But we are also planning on moving the date
further back.
Further back. Next year.
So hopefully, you know, with us moving it back, it's going to be warmer because a lot of guys wanted to come down and be able to fish also.
Yeah. And also tax season.
Plus tax season be up, you know. Yeah.
Get that greens and start buying more.
Fishing season already be started.
You'll get all this fun. There's a lot of flavor companies that I heard there. They said, man, we did great.
Barbershop did good. Beepers did good.
Yep.
Shout out to Big Money Beepers, one of our sponsors.
One of our sponsors today's show, Big Money Beepers from Mike Thornburg. Thank you for your sponsorship for this year again. We are always going to display. Matter of fact, we got a little banner up there in the corner. And then there you go.
Those banners, we got room for a couple more banners out there.
Yeah. So whoever wants to sponsor us, but
just reach out. We don't.
We don't bite, do we?
No. You know, you guys can talk to Mike Thornburg. We don't. You know, we're not.
Man, I wish I could smoke
we're not guys. Sitting here trying to. Man. You know, like, hey, we need money. You know, it don't work like that.
Money.
You know, it's not even really about the money. It's just about being a part of something that's going to be greater than us one day.
It's all about the money.
It's not about the money.
No.
But we appreciate everybody that did help us out. You know, everybody that pretty much showed up, probably pretty much did. You know, what's his name? Four Pool Beepers.
Hmm?
Dwayne Davis. You know, he kept bringing these nets over to me. He was like, just give me 100, whatever you make over them. So we was doing it for 150.
Oh, that's awesome.
We would get 50 every time. We did we probably did $200 and maybe $250 in nets just doing that.
Yeah, shout out to him. Thank you. Kenny Mack, thank you, brother, for that chili.
Yeah. Shout out to Kenny Mack for winning. He won.
Oh, he did.
It was only two pots. It was one pot of chili.
Yeah.
and he was the other person.
Yeah.
Wayne Cavanaugh and his wife made some too. They got a Rockstar Pizza gift card too. Yeah,
appreciate that.
Appreciate you guys.
All the sponsors that actually threw money for this that basically just helped out with the Carp Expo. I want to thank every one of you guys.
Yeah.
I think what was one of your favorite items that you thought you liked there?
Probably the coolest items probably there just because I see the fishing stuff all the time.
Yeah.
Would probably be the carp cutouts.
Cole Smith. Yeah. That's what I was going to say too. I thought,
you know what I mean? If he had the time to have somebody like paint or airbrush them, that'd look cool.
I thought it'd be a really good idea for Cole Smith and Michael Thornburg to team up.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know.
Oh, I'm sure they talked.
Yeah, did they?
I'm sure they got something in mind.
That would be kind of cool. See how, like, American flag on a carp. You know,
Zach,
carp,
Cole, Chris, Corey. But yeah, we appreciate everybody, you know, that drove hours and hours get here.
Yeah.
You know, we hope it was worth your while. Yeah, that's too much.
Jeez.
Let's call it Iceman.
Yeah, let's call Iceman. Let's get him going.
Hopefully he's fishing right now.
No, he's not. He just got off work. But he said he's working around like here.
See that new sticker, boy?
Sinister
Six. Called the Sinister Six.
Hello.
What's up, Richie?
The Iceman.
Man. How you doing, brother? Welcome to Park Pop.
Doing okay. How you guys doing?
Not too bad. Not too bad.
Are you fishing?
No.
No. Got home late from work, later than I wanted to. And I'd rather be fishing, yeah. But
with
it's 50 degrees.
Yeah.
I mean, in Akron, Ohio, that's crazy.
We're about 56
for February.
Yeah, during
having
the daytime.
A little fire.
Huh?
During the daytime.
Yeah. I mean, what's your temperature right now?
You 50 said, degrees.
50 degrees.
Yeah.
We're, there's no way we're 50 degrees out there right now.
I bet you we're 50 degrees right now.
No way.
Yeah. They're like one state. He's a little bit farther up north, too.
Right, it's got to be close.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. He's right next door to us.
Right on Kenny Myers.
Yep.
Man, Richie.
Appreciate you, bro.
It's been 2 years since we talked to you last on Carp Talk, brother.
Yeah, time flies. Yeah. I wish I was back on the ice, because if it was ice, believe me, we'd be talking on the ice.
Yeah. I mean, it was like last time we were talking, he was on the ice fishing, and now you didn't catch anything, but always hoping. But that's what fishing's all about. That's called fishing. So it's like.
Well, I did catch a fish after we talked that
night. Oh, did you? Awesome. Damn.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. When it comes to the ice fishing, they are kind of predictable about when they're going to bite.
Yeah. Man, I tell you, I would love. You want to go down to Ohio one of these days?
And like, I'd love to.
Around like, but you know, we can't give out a secret spot. You know what I mean?
No, it wouldn't be.
I'm sure it's a secret spot. Is it a secret spot, Richie?
If it is a secret spot, there's plenty of trees and bushes.
That is a secret spot, Richie.
Well, I mean.
He's laughing, so that means, yeah. It's like that's a nervous laugh. Either. Like, oh my God, why am I coming on the show now?
Yeah.
No, we wouldn't do that to you, Richie. Hey, well, you good?
No. I honestly can't believe that more people don't catch fish on the ice.
Man.
Because for me, it's extremely easy and predictable.
Right. How would, I mean, when it comes to ice fishing, and I haven't caught a carp out of ice yet, and I'm pretty sure it gets, if you persist, basically on it.
Yeah.
You know, like a day before, you go to that one spot of the ice and then you chum it, and then you maybe come back the next day and then you start again, right? You know.
Well, this is what I've come down to. I mean, this is
the science of it.
This is how it is, okay? If you fish all the time,
right.
If you're fishing 3-4 days a week or whenever you can go out and as much as possible, the last place you caught carp before it froze, you're going to catch them on the ice.
Right.
If you catch them the day before it freezes, you'll catch them 5 days later with the ice on it.
Yeah.
Because whenever it unfreezes, you'll catch them. You'll go back there and you'll catch them. So it's like a place that you know 100% you're going to catch fish every time you go there.
Wow. Okay.
What's going on, everybody? Ricky, Phil, appreciate you, Phil.
So before the ice came, you basically say okay, but you know that spot pretty sure, but it's more easier. When you hog out the hole and then you throw a line right to that spot, right?
Richard? Yeah, I mean, yeah, pretty much.
Okay.
I mean,
yeah.
I don't really change up much from if I was casting to that spot or if I was drilling a hole on top of it.
Do you use a different type of test line when you?
Well, I mean,
does that change
for ice fishing? There's different types of line that are for ice fishing, and if it's got a coating on, it's a little bit easier to handle. But I mean, you can use braid. And then the only thing I really change is my leader.
Okay,
I use monofilament for my leader, and then my hook lengths are monofilament also. For my hairs, they're also monofilament.
Okay,
make it a little bit stiffer. That's about the only difference, but. Everything else is just the same as if I was, casting out to the spot.
Gotcha.
Still using corn, or?
Yeah, and, I have a couple different spots that I don't really have a problem catching them if there's no ice on there. And if it freezes up, I can just wait for it to get to go out on it.
Right.
And then as soon as it unfreezes, you can go catch them again. That's what boggles my mind. I've been waiting for my buddies. There's a whole bunch of guys out there that's been trying. And it's like, gosh, one of you guys have got to get one. I mean, it's such a rush to get a carp on the ice.
Oh, man.
I'm just waiting for somebody. Hopefully we get, like here in Ohio, you never know, maybe in March we'll get another polar vortex where it's super cold and we'll get to go out ice fishing again. But I know there's other guys out there trying. And it's like I'm waiting for somebody to
I feel
get
like
it
it's
down, to say this isn't that hard.
Right. There's no science to it, really, right? It's just
If you know where the fish are and you know that it's your honey hole.
Yeah.
You know you can catch them. The only thing that's blocking you is an auger and a hole that you can cut through the ice.
Yeah. So what's the the biggest?
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing.
Your biggest carp you caught? You brought out of the ice
this year?
Oh. This year, I only got to fish for a week. We had a polar vortex that come through, they call it, and we got super cold temps, and really it sucks to have to go to work and work out it all day and then come home and go, oh, okay, well, I'm going to go ice fishing. But I knew I had a week to fish, and then it was going to warm back up again. So for a week, it was super cold, and I went out after work, and I only caught small ones because whenever it's cold like that, that seems like the small fish are the only ones really moving around. Gotta warm up. These are river temps most of the time, so that gets the bigger ones going. But when it's cold like that, I'm glad to catch any carp on the ice.
Oh, yeah.
Really, I've been looking forward to it. I didn't get to go last year. It was like this.
Oh, you did?
Too warm? You got just enough ice to make you not be able to go fishing, and you have to wait for it to unfreeze. And right now, I'm in that situation like last year where you can't even go fishing because there's like an inch of ice on everything.
Yeah, so, I mean, I try to go ice fishing every year, you know, especially around February time. Here around the Indianapolis area, I have to go up a little bit farther up north.
By Michigan?
Yeah, oh, pretty close, yeah. Maybe like a couple of hours just up north just to fish. Now we did have some pretty good solid ice here in Indianapolis, but I felt like I only had a week to fish it, just the way the structure and the weather was putting up with it. And I missed my weekend, and I had life just got in the way, so you know, things
definitely.
So
I did get out, and I probably got about 10 fish in that week. And I had to fish colder days, which made me have to, you know, take my cradle out, put water in it, because you can't just pull a carp up out of the hole and try to get pictures of him when it's 18 degrees and he's just sitting there.
Yeah.
So you've got to put him in some water. So it gets, you know, it's an extra fish care. When it gets above freezing, you can have a mat out, put him on a mat and stuff.
But you know, I never thought about that. So you have to have like another cradle full of water.
I got a resistance tackle cradle years ago from Dennis Moneypenny. His cradles had a cover over them that would if you stuck the cover over it while it was out, you know,
right,
and ready, you could put water in that and it would hold water. So that was the ticket. Otherwise, it was not very carp friendly to pull them up out of the, you know, hole when it's 18 degrees.
Yeah.
But unless you're in a shanty. And I'm never sitting in a shanty because I'm sitting there watching tip-ups.
Yeah. Do you fish at nights?
That's when I had to go out. I mean, I worked and
oh, okay,
until,
gotcha, gotcha.
You know, 5:30, 6 o'clock, and then I had to go out and it was a window of opportunity.
Yeah, yeah.
If you don't go during those, whenever the opportunity is there, you're not going to catch them on the ice. But the thing is, they're so easy to get on the ice if you just know they're there and go do it.
Have a little faith.
Yeah. I watched Andrew Walker. I said this last time he was on this podcast up in Canada.
Yeah.
And I mean, I'm one guy watching him do it, and there's got to be other guys who can do this.
As far as I know, you're I think you might be like the
one of the only people that I know that really goes ice fishing. Like yeah, goes ice fishing. You know, on the regular, like every year.
Yeah, and I want to catch ice. I want to catch a carp out of the ice so badly. I mean, all I'm catching is bluegills.
Oh, I tell you what, it blows everything you've ever, the adrenaline rush you get out of the water because it's such a holy crap, that's a carp on the end of the line on the ice.
Yeah.
And I still get excited over it. I mean, I've been doing it for a long time now, and every time that flag goes up, I don't even give a crap if it's a 2-pounder, it's still a carp on the ice to me. It's like, right on.
Now, I did see you had, from one of your Facebook posts, you had some a different type of contraption, like pod.
I build patio rooms. Last time I talked to you, I was towing cars. Well, I quit doing that just to try to help, to get a little bit more a little bit more my repertoire as far make a little bit more money and build patio rooms. And we deal with a foam that's about 3 inches thick, and they stick my bank sticks in there, my alarms, and heck, I can take that on there and out there just like if I was sticking them in the ground and use my little ice fishing rods.
Nice.
It works out great.
It looks like it worked out great. That was pretty.
And it's light. It doesn't, it's not heavy. It's not, because it seems like I'm taking more. Look, I really do have a lot into going out on the ice.
Right.
It seems like there's just, a whole bunch of stuff because I normally go light. The little foam doesn't weigh much. I can take two of those out there and use two rods, and the rest of them are tip-ups.
So, do you chum the day before or that day?
Honestly, like I was saying, these spots, I don't have to.
Okay,
these fish come off of a river. Uh-huh. They're active, and they eat.
Yeah, because they're active.
They do not care whatsoever that there's ice above them.
Yeah.
Okay.
You just figure out the windows of opportunity, and you just fish like if it was any other day. They're going to eat.
It ain't no different than you getting off work. Like, man, I worked my ass off. I'm tired and I'm hungry.
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
When they come out of that stream, they're like, man, I just had to work to get up here. Like, I didn't work up an appetite. Let me go see.
They just don't eat as much, but they still. Sweet.
So what's the biggest carp you caught out of the ice?
My biggest carp, I caught two of them, two 20s, two 22 pounders, right around 22, 23 pounds in the same day. So I have two of them over 20 on the ice.
That's nice.
Yeah, that's real nice.
Did you have to drill a bigger hole?
The only reason they fit was because I fished the day before and it rained, and then whenever I went out the next day, the holes had gotten bigger because the water was draining down into them, because the river, the ice kind of flows up and it drains off the top. Mm-hmm. So my holes are a little bit bigger. Otherwise, the one fish I would not have gotten out of an 8-inch hole.
Wow.
But an 8-inch hole, you'd be surprised.
Yeah.
There'd be a lot of fish. Like the first one was a torpedo. Fish. They come out easier than they go in sometimes.
Yeah, nice. Do you catch anything other fish out of the ice besides carp?
Suckers.
If I'm fishing
for for carp, I get suckers.
Okay, gotcha. What was another question I was going to ask?
Whoa.
No. I got it.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
You know, the one thing I wanted to say though is for these guys that are still trying, I'm telling you, you get on these fish and you'll have as many bites as you would, because if you take consideration, you can have so many tip ups and two rods.
Yeah.
You can take advantage of that. And look, I can sit there. And I could tell which tip-up was going to get a bite and how long it was going to take before I got that bite.
Nice.
That's crazy. I knew that if I waited so long, a certain tip-up would get a bite. And then the fish would move around. And then you'd get bites that were like 25, 30 feet away from different holes. So these fish are moving all around.
Yeah.
Wow. You know, and that's like pretty cool that you can track them like that too by seeing which flags are popping up.
Oh, yep, exactly. So you've got to take advantage to whatever your state offers. I mean, right now we're at 3 rods and 6 tip-ups. That's 9 lines.
Oh my God, really? So for ice fishing, you have 9 tip-ups?
You should look and see what you guys have in Indiana.
I never really thought of that.
Six tip-ups here in Ohio and 3 rods.
Yeah.
I bet you guys aren't far off.
Yeah, we might not be far off.
Yeah, we're 3 rods for sure.
Yeah, we're 3 rods here for sure, yeah.
So you're probably 6 tip-ups as well. So you could fish 9 lines, and
Somebody Google that for Indiana real quick. How many tip-ups for ice fishing are you guys allowed?
For here, in Ohio, it's 6.
6. I'm just curious.
Somebody look it up for us real quick.
Yeah, so if they don't mind.
Babe, let me see your phone. Look this up.
But, besides ice fishing now, I mean, you're still the masters of the water. And you've done summertime.
Oh, I'm going up to Lake Erie.
Oh, that's right.
Oh yeah, we talked about that. We got some spots. There's a few of us that are pretty hardcore. You know, like you guys down there in Indiana, we're still fishing.
Man, Lake Erie.
I go up to Lake Erie, and we have some backwaters that the fish are just piled in.
Yeah, that's they're hitting that shallow water right now. They was doing that in Texas where we was at.
And look, right now you'll catch the biggest fish you're going to catch all year if you get lucky. I mean, they're just big hogs sitting in these piles of fish.
Yeah. So, are you throwing a line in Lake Erie?
Does a bear sit in the woods, Dan? yeah, he said, "Are you getting a line wet when you're there?"
Well, I mean, what was you meaning there?
No, are you going to fish in Lake Erie?
Oh, I've been going up. If I can't be on the ice, that's where I've been going these last couple of weekends. That's where I've gotten my fish at lately.
Wow, that's price monsters. What's the biggest one you caught out of there?
I'm 25, it's the spot that I'm fishing now, it's just the backwater lagoons.
Yeah, okay, I can dig it. Okay, all right.
You know, people have their boat docks and whatnot to go back into the marinas and whatnot.
Yeah.
And, you know, in most of your Great Lakes, and if you get back into those, the carp just pile up in those.
How far is Lake Erie from you?
Hour.
There, okay, I can dig it.
That's worth the drive.
Yeah, I mean.
Oh my God! You can't wait. It's you're ready to do it.
Yeah, I think ours is about 2.5 hours from Lake Michigan, from us here for Indianapolis area.
You know what? If I was 2.5 hours away, I'd still make the drive. just to fish that big waters. So
oh my God!
Because your imagination runs wild.
Is it? Hell, I was just watching. Because, of course, when you got through all the Great Lakes on there, you know, of course, you got some iron ships that sinks in those areas. Like, just like I just heard about Lake Superior. They just found a ship that wrecked over 80 years ago or something like that in Lake Superior. And they just found it. And I guess the only person that died in there was the captain off of a bar. I don't know. Long story. Look it up. But, you know, I can just imagine all kinds of fish and how deep those waters are, and there's no telling what you pull out of that.
There's no telling.
So, anybody threw out the, what's going on, guys? It's going Road and Rusty, Jason.
What wild water tournaments are you fishing this year? If you don't mind me asking.
I'll tell you what, I'm going to be 100% honest, man. Everything's gone up, you know, in prices. You go to the grocery store,
man,
this and that.
Yeah.
I'm not definitely not made of money. So now it's priorities in life, you know. I'd like to go fish tournaments. After I won that tournament up there, and up on Lake Onondaga, for wild carp tournaments.
Yeah.
Up there in Seneca River and all that.
You accomplished what you set out for.
I was really kind of happy. I got a 40-pounder.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? During the tournament, you know, so I was kind of happy with, you know, where I was at with the tournaments, and kind of just like, man, I need to adjust to the way our economy is and stuff, because it's expensive to go fish these tournaments. Everything's turned to boilies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, when you're spending more money on boilies than you are to tournament, something's wrong.
Yeah, you know? For sure.
I mean, and it's the thing is, you have to. It's not even a yeah. it's not even a question. If you don't do it, then you're in trouble.
Yeah.
So I've just kind of got to a point where it's like,
and I've seen it from my own eyes. You guys baited nonstop. They baited.
Oh yeah.
Boilies.
It's expensive. You're just throwing the money in there.
Now, do you when you do say like in your past and when you're doing those tournaments and you got sponsors helping you out with those boilies?
No, I don't like the pressure.
Gotcha.
You know, I don't like the, I just don't like the pressure.
Yeah.
You know, but I have my own tournaments here in Ohio with, with the group that I have.
Yeah, we're talking about that.
We have them once a month, and they're almost like a pay lake. They're wild water pay lake type of tournaments where they pay out by the hour.
Okay.
And you know, that right there, that's something I've done since I was a kid, and, as long as I'm doing those, I have to do some competitive carp fishing because that's just in my blood. So as long as I'm doing that, I just can't afford the big tournaments right now.
Do you have a schedule for that? Like where
those tournaments are the last Saturday of every month.
Okay.
That's easy. It's easy as that. That's what I have them. They're normally 12-hour tournaments, and we. You know, put a couple bucks in per hour, and we pay out big fish for big catfish, big carp, and, you know, have a good time.
Yeah, I used to do that a while back.
We used to try to go one of them, James, make a video.
Oh, yeah.
Be pretty cool.
I used to do tournaments all the time off of my lake where I worked at, called West Lake, and I was doing cats and carp together at one time.
Right. It makes it fun.
It does. It really does. And then
when you're not catching carp, you're catching catfish.
Exactly. And then
might as well win something.
Yeah. And I mean, I actually had a lot of people come from different parts of the state, especially like Illinois, just come to those tournaments a lot of times.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they're laid back. They're fun.
Yeah. Exactly. And
people bring me the fish, and they when they get there, that's when their hour is, and that's when I weigh it, and if whoever gets the biggest carp and biggest catfish, you can win some pretty decent money.
Yeah.
You know, you get $60 an hour going on, you know, and then $600 for big payout for big fish. Somebody's gonna go home happy.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you in your tournaments? Do you do trophies?
No. It's just everything goes back 100% in cash.
Gotcha.
And, I mean, everybody likes a trophy here and there. Yeah, but I'll be honest with you. I have a bunch of trophies, and look, they just collect dust.
Yeah. Tommy's kind of dusty a little bit.
I just pulled a bunch of them out of a box, and they was. Yeah. James is like, put them up on the shelf. I'm like, man, they all ain't clean. They're dusty.
right. So everybody wants cash. It's like your birthday. You know, don't. I mean, just give me some cash.
Yeah, for sure.
But well, jeez. Anything you think new this year that you're gonna plan on doing? Like,
I mean, just try and you know, keep on keeping on and.
Yeah.
Glad to have, you know, friends like you guys to be able to talk to and you know, just makes you want to, you know, make every day the best you can.
I'm a big fan of you, bud.
Yeah, absolutely.
Every morning I wake up, the man will be like Richie.
You got to see him in action, though,
man. I want to be like Richie when I grow up.
I wish I would have took some pictures.
Down there, Texas?
No, we took a lot of pictures and videos and stuff. But I'm talking about I was in New York, and I want to say when he won it, did you win overall, win everything, or just your section?
That was the section that year.
Yeah, but just seeing him, you know, watching them work and, you know, do the boilie paint campaign and everything. And him waiting out there, you know, just letting 20-pound fish go, like, you know, grabbing it, swooping it up in his hand, unhooking it, still in the water.
That's my thing right there. I try to pass that along to everybody. You can lift them carp up off the water if you do it right. Just slide your hand under the belly, pick them up a little bit, pop the hook out, and psh, they're gone. Yeah.
So you're doing the waders thing too and all that stuff?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, gotcha. Yeah.
Yeah, he had chest deep waders on.
For sure. is there a certain brand name company you go through, or is, you know, like a
you mean for boilies?
What is that? I'm sure. What do you do for these? You just only use boilies only, or do you use pack bait? Do you use flavors or just corn?
No. Whenever all them tournaments is, I mean that's 100% Carp Max.
Carp Max, gotcha.
Yeah. Carp Max.
Thomas Vitigetti.
It's 100%.
Ain't it Thomas Vitigetti or something like that? I can't pronounce it.
I think I tried to get him on the show one time.
Yeah.
I don't think he was interesting. I mean, he was interested, but he just...
He makes some boilies, man. He brings, yeah, he, I he just brings think, a whole band full when he comes.
I think I tried to get him on the show.
Plus, I mean,
two, 3 years ago,
some people order a bunch of them.
And then, I think he was just so wrapped up in, you know, with his business and all.
Oh, he's definitely, yeah, definitely.
You know, the band says,
and plus, if you did get him on the show, he'd be on there for like 4 or 5 hours.
Oh yeah,
Talks for long.
Oh, we get some talkers.
Hey, they've caught some big fish though. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Well, that, I mean,
you're talking about a boilie campaign.
Those baits, and a good partner is 100% why I've done as well as I have.
Yeah.
You've got some good stuff. Definitely good stuff. But, wow. So, you got any lakes that you plan on going to this year? Or, I mean, besides Lake Erie?
No. Lake Erie is where it's at. Yeah. I mean, honestly. Yeah. That lake is, I mean, you just drive up there and you see that looks like an ocean.
Oh, definitely.
It's you just, your mind just goes crazy.
Now, how often do you normally go up there?
I try to go up there every weekend if I can, but at least 3 times out of the month.
And what's your biggest from there?
That's my PB is 41.11.
41.
From there?
Yeah.
Now, when you go down there, do you chum?
Oh yeah. You know, those fish don't. I mean, they're. The big fish up there, they like to eat meat, so they're not afraid to eat a fish.
Yeah.
You know? So your bait is like nothing they even really care about. So they are tricky to catch.
Yeah.
But if you do bait them, the thing is, there's so many carp up there that sometimes they'll get a bunch of hybrids that'll come in. And they're like a hybrid goldfish carp. And they'll just destroy your swim. Mm. You'll catch nonstop, like, 5 to 10 pound hybrids.
Yeah. You ever catch a mirror up there?
Oh yeah. Plenty.
Yeah.
There's gorgeous mirrors up there.
Okay. You dig it. Yeah.
What's your biggest koi? Did we ask him that? Last
I think week? We did ask him that before. But I mean,
you
this
ever caught a koi?
Yeah. Surprisingly, most people that catch koi, they stalk them. They see them.
Yeah.
My biggest koi, I did not do that. It was totally unexpected. Wasn't a huge koi. I mean, it's only 16-pound fish.
I mean, that's a pretty big koi.
But it was in a reservoir that I had no clue that I was going to catch that fish.
Yeah.
So to see it pop up in front of me, it was actually it's probably my favorite fish I've ever caught in my life. Yeah. I mean, I can catch super huge fish, but to get something like that, you know, it's gorgeous fish. Out of the blue, somebody let that fish go in there, you know.
Right. And it just got bigger.
It's like a tagged fish, you know. It's like you're awfully lucky to catch it.
Yeah, for sure. I can only imagine.
Do you 16 pound? You ever use tiger nuts?
Yeah, and I've caught fish on tiger nuts, but I've honestly, I mean, it's comes down to like boilies. You almost condition them to eat them.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's not like corn where you can just like plop it in front of them and they're like, hey, I think I'm going to eat that. You know?
You mainly use boilers on them, do you do snowmans on them?
No. A lot of people think that a snowman is the way to catch a big fish.
Yeah.
That is not.
Yeah.
That is not the way that it works. A single hook bait that they have to, you know, choke down is the way to go, because a carp's mouth, if you have 3 20-millimeter boilies on a hair, okay?
Right.
It's still only 20 millimeters around. You know what I mean? It's not very big around. Now look, a 10, 15-pound carp, from his lips to the back of his throat where he has his crunch, where he crunches, it could be 7-8 inches long.
Wow.
If you see a carp skull,
right,
there's a long ways between their mouth and where they're crunching.
Yeah.
So the 20-millimeter bait could have 5 baits on it and still not reach the back of its throat.
Okay.
So the way that you catch the big fish is a bigger bait, the 24s, the 26s, 28s, 30s.
Yeah.
Gotcha. I mean, they're just big baits.
Okay, I dig it. So do you think that carp sees color?
I'm gonna say that they recognize their own color in their environments, because
gotcha.
You know what I mean?
Right.
I have certain colors that I like that are, like, for instance, I have red pop-up foam.
Okay.
But it can't be like any red. This is blood red pop-up foam.
Yeah.
And I have orange pop-up corn, you know, but it can't be just like any orange pop-up corn, like different shades of that orange. Mm-hmm. And the same with pink, you know, or just different colors of different, you know, like pop-ups. But depends on the water clarity as well.
Yeah.
Some places that I go to, like, when I go up to Lake Erie, they like the 4-0 yellow, you know, that high-vis yellow.
Yellow, yeah.
And then I'll go to other places where they don't touch it.
What color you think they see the best?
You know what? In my opinion, I really like orange.
Orange? Gotcha. You ever seen that video? And I think it came from Carpology, if I'm not mistaken, where there are so many depths they have for certain colors. And they said that for the deeper the water, green was the best color for the deepest part of the water. Have you ever seen that kind of video?
I fish for other fish, you know, as well. So like Pico bass fishing and stuff like that, they do the same thing with the lures.
Yeah. So, I mean, I thought it was a very interesting video at one time, too. So.
Oh, yeah.
But.
Yep, I mean, we all have a bunch of tackle, though, you know, and that's what makes us fishermen. If one thing's not working, we just go to the next and, you know, see if the next color will do it for us because of the water color.
Right.
A lot of times that I've found that it's not our bait at all. It's because the water is so damn clear and they see your damn line.
Mm. But do you think that's a problem?
During the daytime, I do.
Yeah, gotcha. So
what line do you prefer to use, you know, like during the day?
Clear green.
you know what? I, like I said, I'm kind of on the poor side. So Berkeley Big Game in the green.
I'm right there with you, bud.
It's right, guys. It worked. It's worked for me for probably where I want.
See, that's what I got on my lines. Green, Big Burka, yeah. And Dwan and Ricky said, oh, no, not that one. Not that line. You know, I'm like, what's wrong with my line? He's, oh, we can't get it. And he's thinking, I'm scared of fish away. I'm like, I don't know. You know how that
is. I love Berkeley Big Game.
Yeah.
It's cheap. And
everybody's different. Everybody's different.
Yeah, that green is fine for me.
I mean, this is why we do carp talk. Because, you know, I think every carp angler has a different perspective on what they do that works for them.
Different tricks and stuff, different knowledge.
Yeah, and this is what we just basically, we talk about carp fishing and just learn off each other, you know? And,
So, exactly right. Yeah. I had a newbie come fish with us last weekend.
Yeah.
Was a bass fisherman. He never fished for carp before in his life.
Oh, wow.
And we had him for a day, and we was on a pile of fish. He's hooked. He's
nice.
He loves it. you know, it's changed his whole perspective on how to, you know, fight a fish and set your drag. And, you know, he realized that carp fishing was a little bit more complicated than he thought.
It's definitely changing.
Yeah.
It's changing everywhere, too. Like, for instance, when I was in Texas, and, you know, I don't know if James is going to put this part in the first video or if he's going to do a video all by itself on it. But when I was down there, Fish and Wildlife came up and was talking to Austin Anderson.
That's probably in the middle.
Yeah, the buffalo there, about how big they are and, you know, how long have they been there? Why are they growing so big? You know, and they're scientists is what they are.
Yeah.
You know, they're really interested in, they want to protect them. You know what I mean? They want to.
Well, that's going on in Arizona as well. They got a similar program where they're working on one specific lake.
Which is good because they're curious. They want to know, you know, how are these buffalo getting to be 60 and 70 pounds?
Just like down there home.
Yeah, how long these fish been here? That's really what they want to know.
They'll live for 100 years.
Yeah, and he was telling me, you know, these scientists, they was pretty smart, man. He was telling me about, you know, how you can identify how old they are, and he said you can look at their scales and look, but he said to get them more accurate, you know, on identifying how old these fish are, they would have to kill a couple of them.
Yeah.
And their ear bone.
Their ear bone?
Wow.
Yep. Yeah, because that's, you know, it's some that's
the ear bone.
That part, it's been, you know, it's part of its head. It's been there the longest. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
And obviously it grows from being small to big. Because some of these buffalo, like their face and their head would be kind of small, and their mouth would be really big.
Okay.
But then their body was just, it just looks like they just been down there just working out or something, man. I'm serious, man. It's crazy to see how broad these fish are.
You ever catch a buff, Rich?
Yeah, Lake Erie's got them. As a matter of fact, I've stalked them at nighttime.
Nice.
Yeah, because they don't feed in the water column like weird. So yeah. You can almost, like at nighttime, you can stalk them. You can almost just like drop a bait real slow in the middle of the water column, right in front of their face.
Oh,
and
wow.
Watch them suck it in. Yeah. They're not even wanting to really eat, but they'll still suck it in.
Yeah, for sure.
It's odd. It's odd. But Stuart Black is the one that has that program out in Arizona. It's a big deal over on Patchy Lake. Same thing as what they're, you know, Austin's probably, you know, doing over there.
Okay.
Big program, trying to limit, you know, the bow fishermen from killing off these native fish that have been there for a long, long time.
Yeah, and it's hard telling how long these buff been there, because their record there is like 70, recorded is like 70 or 71. Then there was another one that beat it, but I think it wasn't recorded.
Right, right.
Well, I'll tell you guys right now, the fish that I see in my headlight or my headlamp when I'm up on Lake Erie, there's bigger buffalo than that in Lake Erie.
Really?
I see blips.
How far is Lake Erie?
I mean, the fish you see at nighttime with the headlamp up there will just blow your mind.
About 4 hours. It could be. How far? I wonder how far Lake Erie is from Indianapolis.
6 hours.
Siri.
Yeah. Is it really 6 hours? Because you guys, Indianapolis, Indiana is only like 3.5 hours from me. You guys got to be less than four and a half hours.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking about, 3.5, 4 hours.
Well, it takes him about an hour. Okay, so yeah, maybe about 4 hours.
Maybe a little bit longer, but not be under five.
Yeah.
I've been down to Jimmy's place, the West Side Bait and Tackle.
Yeah. I miss that place.
So it didn't take us but 3.5 hours, I think, to get down to his place.
Yeah.
Do you have a bait boat?
Yeah. I actually get in it and take it out. I sit in it.
Oh, kayak.
that's my bait boat.
Yeah.
No, well, I'm serious. That's been my carp fishing. I got a local lake that I'm not going to Lake Erie that I take my boat out.
Oh, Buff Maxter coming on. I seen you pop up, old Buff Maxter.
Yeah.
Old Mac Main.
RJ Right Grander, he goes, mix grits, oats, and soybean, and red raspberry, killer wild water bait.
All right, you guys out there watching, any of you guys got any questions?
What's up, Kenny?
For Richie, I know, you know, we got about 15, 16 people on here.
Oh, yeah, man.
Ask them a couple questions. I know you guys might want to ask mine.
So, do you have a lot of problems with bow anglers up there?
Ohio is horrible.
Really?
One of the worst places you could be for that.
Man.
Because we're a big, big bass fishing state, and fishermen do not like carp. Our regulations are crap. So,
do you think...
But on the flip side, we have a few lakes that's got bow hunted hard that we are now seeing bigger carp because of that.
Okay.
So there's a little bit of, you know, not so bad there with the bow fishing, but it needs regulated.
Yeah, so it's kind of like regulated, even things out a little bit.
Better fish.
Do you, brain fart, dude. I just had that. Man. Okay.
RJ Gardner says, do you fish paid lakes or just wild water?
Wild water.
Just wild water.
Yeah.
Do you got paid lakes like that in Ohio that are carp or just catfish?
I have to go down towards Cincinnati, Ohio River area. Uh-huh. They do have paid lakes down that way. Most of them are catfish paid lakes, though.
Yeah. I think there's this one over there, if I remember right, it's like a horseshoe?
Where?
In Ohio area?
Oh, I don't know.
I don't know. Around Cincinnati area.
Well, there's quite a few down towards the Ohio River, Cincinnati area.
A lot of big cats in them places, too.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
They get them out of the river.
Yeah. I'm sure there's people out there that fish for them and then, you know, turn around and probably sell them to the lakes.
Oh, yeah, because there's not a rod limit. You can use as many rods as you want.
Yeah, like you can use like 99, can't you? That's how it is in Texas.
It's
you can have up to like 100 rods.
Yep. It's nuts.
Have you fished for... do you get a lot of... here's that question I got now. Do you think the Asian carp is towards... kind of gives the... common carp a bad name?
Mm-hmm.
When people say it's carp, actually, like Asian carp, you know,
right? Yeah,
I feel like
the fact is that carp is a slang term no matter what.
Yeah,
and people don't, they just don't, it just doesn't, I don't know why it doesn't set in with them that it's a slang term, that there's many things involved in that slang term. And the common carp is really a goldfish. And that's what I tell people. It's like, look, a carp is a goldfish. And then it kind of changes their outlook on it.
Yeah.
You know? Because goldfish are pretty dang smart if you ever have them in your fish tank. So they can relate to that.
Right.
You know? As long as it's got a slang term, we're not going to do so well on it. We just have to educate people. And
get
more people out there and do it. And they are. It's just... look, it's really not grown a lot and as fast as I thought it would. But we are getting there.
Yeah. I always thought that anything that had the word carp, especially when it's got the barb whiskers, that should be kind of, you know, that's what, a carp's name should be. I do believe that the word Asian carps, I believe that name needs to be changed. You know, maybe call them Asian fish. I don't know.
He said, I don't know.
I don't know, man. I think whoever come up with that name, like scientists or whatever, I'm sure they got a whole crazy name for it in scientific terms.
Well, aren't they it's carp, it's silver carp or whatever they
want. Yeah, silver carp.
And they still say carp.
They still say carp, yeah.
Yeah.
As long as the word carp's in there, it's going to be tough.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I know the grassy carp.
Yeah.
But, of course, grassies, they don't have a barb on it or...
Well, they're not even carp at all.
No, you're right. They're not.
An Amur is not a carp whatsoever.
Yeah, Asian's not a carp.
It got labeled as a carp, and people go out to kill them, and they don't realize that
they're killing a regular common.
So many of them, and it disrupts. like in Texas, where they started killing all those grass carp, and then they started reintroducing those grass carp back there.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, oops, we made a mistake because
yeah, now look at all the weeds. We don't even have a pond no more.
Right, exactly. So, it's the whole carp, you know, persona. And yeah. I go up to Lake Erie, and it's a bad word. Really, it is. I have to go out there and fish and have people come up to me and see me reel in the fish and go, well, what is it? And then you get it in there, it's like, it's a carp, and then you can see that confused look on their face.
Yeah.
Right? And then it's like, well, if they stick around long enough, just hand the rod to them, and
oh, after
a while, they're like, they don't care, they're having a good time.
Yeah. Yes.
So you just gotta, everybody that comes across to you that you can, just try to, let them see
education a little bit, and let's
different side, yeah.
I mean, I got excited when I caught my first carp. I'm like, oh my God, I was hooked after that.
So, I didn't care what the fish was.
No. I was the same way. I thought I was the best little channel cat fisherman that ever lived. I was going out to Pine Lakes a lot. Really, Rainbow Lake is where I started because it was right by the house. I had my mama drop me off.
Yeah.
And I'd walk home in the morning time when I was done fishing, my pass was up.
How old were you?
Yeah. When I was there, probably about 14.
14?
When I started. Okay. When I was able to get dropped off from home. But I was going at like 11 and 12 because my brother was older.
Gotcha.
He was able to go, so.
Yeah. So, but.
Anybody got any more questions?
Yeah. So what? You do use pack bait, don't you?
Oh, yeah. I use pack bait all the time.
Is there like a different type of pack bait that you
I don't understand your question, Kenny.
Is there some kind of pack bait that you use that you what's in your pack bait that you like to use?
Or cocaine.
No, I'm simple. I like to use everything that's plain. I don't really use a lot of flavors.
Panko and all that kind of stuff
just sweet corn and cream corn and panko and oats, but I do like to use pellets from the tractor supply.
Yeah.
The tractor supply has different types of pellets. They have calf manna. So different types of the times of the year, like now I like to use calf manna. It's got a speed stimulant in it. Okay. It's anise flavored and I'll put those pellets in there.
Nice.
But I like to use pellets.
Okay. Ever use range coops?
What's that?
Have you ever used range cubes?
Range cubes in my neck of the woods just brings catfish and lots of them.
Ah, gotcha.
I mean, these catfish are big enough to push the carp out. Like the carp don't even want to be there.
Oh, wow.
Kenny Max got, this is going to be a good one. He said, would he do 69 days in a row? Like, would you fish 69 days in a row, fish every day forever? What is the ideal cutoff for him? Shannon Pearson said, hey, what's doing? What's going on, Unc?
Was that a question?
No, that was just in the middle of all that. Kenny Mack said his longest trip, I think, straight is 30 days.
I've lived on my hometown lake twice.
Okay.
So it's into my backyard. I really don't know how many days that would be, but I mean, I know that I would go there, when I lived there every day. and fish every day for a little while. As long as the weather was good and whatever, whatever else goes on in life. But I mean, I know that there is no cutoff. If I can fish 100 days in a row, I'm going to fish 100 days in a row.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, this is what I always tell people. For me, this is what my problem is, and it's by a curse. But every single day since the first fish I caught in my life, I get up thinking, how can I go fishing today? I may not get there. I may not be able to go, but every day I try to work fishing into my life.
Yeah, yeah.
It could be a curse. Really, it could be.
It's addiction.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, like I said, I don't have a whole lot of money, but I have what I have.
Yeah.
I do what, I don't have any kids, and that's probably because I'm fishing with a different pole.
Yeah.
I'm 48 years old. I just turned 48 in February on the 12th.
Oh, yeah. Well, happy birthday.
And the hardest thing for me now is really just my body. Just like, look, you really want to go out fishing in 18 degrees?
your mind's saying yeah, but your body's saying no.
Right, but I still am making myself go.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's the difference between a lot of people that are trying to catch carp on the ice right now is they're not making them go when they don't want to go because they've worked all day.
Yeah. Kenny Mack said, I'm saying I could do 30 days 100% carp fishing before I am starting to want to leave.
Go to that cabin.
If I could, I'd play like you guys. I don't know. If I could had that opportunity and money wasn't ever an issue or anything like that.
You got kids now.
Yeah, you know what I mean. Like you got a lot of stuff to worry about that stops you know from going.
You there. Get that
house I'm lucky to get a 12. I'm lucky to get a 12 hour session in. Yeah, on a trip.
Well, I'm definitely lucky that I've got Lake Erie up there, and that makes your mind just like endless. So being that close, I just always want to go up and see what I can find next.
Yeah, because you don't know what you're going to catch when you fish a place like that, and that's what.
Oh my gosh, it's so nuts.
Growing up in the Pay Lake
41 pounder that I caught run my drag out for probably a minute straight.
Shannon Pearson's in the house. That's my old buddy right there. Me and him used to go fishing.
That's my uncle.
Stop, man.
You see his last name? Pearson.
That's old. Me and Shannon Pearson won any tournaments together.
I've heard the name. I've heard the name.
Shannon Pearson, yeah. We was in the Hoosier Carpers tournament trail. Jim was doing a team tournament at one time and was going against the Bisonians.
Share this video, you guys.
And
we got 15 people.
We actually got
shares.
First place.
Hit him.
Shan's an awesome. He's an awesome carp angler. So
yeah. I seen him not too long ago.
No related to Tommy here. No relation.
Man, that's Unc, man. That's
no relations.
Asked him. He'll tell you. He's Unc. I'm nephew.
Uncle Pierce.
Now we went to Del Hollow, man, and fished.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, that's right. I forgot
all about that too. Yeah, see, where was you at?
He was
over there with
Tia. That's right. He was
over with Tia.
I was over there with Tia.
I know. I was over there with Amy, so it's all good. Shannon said I could do Del Hollow 364 straight.
Nice.
What are you gonna do with the other day?
Shad caught some hogs at random when we went to Del Hollow that time.
Yeah.
Dude. Well, we all did.
Yeah, we all caught some nice fish.
Yeah, we did. All did.
I hit my PB that day.
Yeah. Yep. I cried.
Huh?
I cried when you had tear in my eye.
Oh, that was a splash. Hey, that
you
was,
had to pay no
I'm
bite.
Not even going to tell you what that was because there's probably some kids watching. that came out of the caddy.
Yeah. Oh.
That's all I'm going to say. It came out the caddy. You know what them fish do in the spring?
No, tell us though. What do they do?
You know what they did.
Good, educate.
There's that pre-cum all in the.
Oh, Lord.
All over James's face.
Lord. Lord. I'm not gonna say it didn't happen.
Oh boy.
Okay. So using a lot of maize. You like the pellets?
I'm still grinding corn.
Right.
I grind everything. I grind it all.
I know. That's where I knew. I guess where I got that from. You came to Jim's place, Westside Bait and Tackle. Uh-huh. I think we had the CCC tournament, and I watched you. That's the very first time I seen it. You had the grinder with the who's the other gentleman was
Bill.
With you.
I think Bill was with
Bill.
Bill Seiler.
Yes. Bill and
it was Bill
and you both started took a hand grinder right there.
I got me an electric meat grinder that makes it all better, and man, I'll tell you what,
a lot faster, huh?
Oh yeah, you can grind up a 5 gallon bucket in no time.
That's the first time I actually seen that.
If summertime comes, I'm grinding all the time, grinding everything.
Yeah, that's the first time I ever seen that situation happen is that when you did that, and That was pretty crazy. That was where the CCC tournament was off of White River, yeah. Over here.
Yep. And, sure was. That's been many moons ago.
I think.
Holy crap!
I think there's actually a video on that from. Is on YouTube, if I'm not mistaken. It's at Carp Anglers.
That was an invitational, I think.
Was it an invitational?
Was it the
CCC.
Brian Norberg was fishing back then.
Yeah.
But do you remember that?
Brian. I think I do know Brian, maybe.
He was the Carp Anglers group president. At one time.
Oh, Brian. Okay.
He fished all the way down to the right at the concrete end.
Oh, right by the zoo. The zoo area. Yeah. We call that that's peg one.
Yeah.
Going by the zoo area.
Yep. So I can't remember if that was a classic or if that was an invitational.
No, I think that was the CCC tournament we had there Jim had a.
You know what? I think you might be right then.
And because
it's been that long ago. I mean, it's been a long time ago.
Yeah, it's been like forever. And we actually had the boiling the boilies or the corn, you know, the day before, because I guess it was a tradition for the. What current time they call it the. It was the way the name started is the Chicago Carp Classics, and then it stopped being hosted in Chicago, so then they call it it's still called CCC term, but there's a what's the term now? It's not the Chicago Carp Classics,
right?
Because it's going to different states now. Oh, wow. Someone's going
to... I haven't fished any of those for a really long time.
Yeah, it's been about a minute. Definitely. But Jim, he threw a day before party and all that stuff. And I've watched you guys. Bill, he had a mustache and beard. You know, older gentleman at the time. And you guys started grinding corn. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, and then like when it started, that corn started being grinded. I'm like, oh my god, it was like a millet ball. You know, you made a millet ball, basically.
Millet ball.
Yeah, millet bomb.
Millet bomb. Yep. Thank you, millet bomb. But
The South Africans for the ones that started grinding corn. That's where that originated from.
You're right. I knew the history because I did a YouTube video on it, and actually there was an African guy actually says that actually started in Africa. You know, he made a comment on my post, and he said that term started in Africa. So there's a little history on the millibomb.
Which is one of the best baits for tournament fishing. That's the South Africans. They dominate carp fishing with that mealy bomb.
Yeah, so
it's a little bit of work. You know, you got to boil it up and grind it up. But once you feel it, it's like this is the way to go.
You want to do a giveaway?
Yeah, let's do a giveaway.
What do we got here?
What do we got?
Got some tournament blend.
Let's do a tournament blend.
Tournament blend.
Okay, we're going to do a giveaway. It's going to be a 3-pound bag. And Tom's going to write down the lucky number for the lucky winner.
Just do 0 to 1,000.
Let's do it.
Zero to 1,000.
Zero to 1,000.
Just to make it quick and simple.
Yeah. Yeah, so, and what a giveaway, and that's it.
After let me that. See. Just pick a number on here.
Huh? Mr. Tom, Tommy's writing the lucky number down. You got the lucky number down?
Yes.
Let me see that lucky number.
Yeah, that way you can...
Gotcha. That's the lucky number. So, go ahead and start now. And... There's all thrown numbers.
Appreciate everybody that's watching and tuning in tonight.
Thank you.
I'm sure Richie appreciates it too. If you guys ain't friends with him already, send him a friend request too. That way you guys.
I enjoyed talking to you guys.
Yeah, we appreciate you being on here, man. We really do. It's good that we get to keep catching up, you know, year after year too.
Actually, our next guest next week, next Wednesday, is going to be Raphael from Carpanger.com.
Yes, who just smashed his PB down there.
Oh, we're down in Texas. Oh, my God.
Yeah, it was, man.
Yeah. What was it, 63?
Yeah, I was hoping for something big like that, man. It just didn't seem to work out.
Yeah.
I was
Hey, you guys. You guys can go a whole lot, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Lake Erie is a lot closer, and I'm telling you, it's
How big you think, just... If you was just guessing a number...
Somebody was really, really close.
If you was just guessing a number on a buff, how big a buff do you think it actually was in Lake Erie for a buff?
Well, I know that I've seen pictures of 50, 60-pound buffs. I mean...
I guess just being able to target them, though.
I know there's big buffalo in there. So and I've seen them, you know, like I said, just watching them in the shoreline. I mean, they're just big fish.
Right. Do you catch them?
A big lake. They're just not easy to catch.
Yeah, I was about to say, when you go, do you catch buffs and commons?
Well, it depends on where you are at on the lake. The particular place that I fish, it all depends on the wind patterns.
Yeah.
So the wind dictates where the buffalo end up being, and if the wind's blowing just right, it'll push it into the harbors. The fish will go with the wind. So you have to kind of watch the weather when you fish the big lake like that. If you get it right, you'll see tons of big buffalo. They'll just come in. They're just big. You don't even know how big they are. Just big.
Wow. Crazy.
I can just imagine, man, if you can just figure them out.
But they're not in there to eat, though. You've got it's like you have to stalk them, you know. So I mean, you could probably bait them in different areas of Lake Erie where they aren't roaming around, but they just seem like they just run around.
Right. Very good. So. I know I probably answered this question. What is the most unusual bait that you ever used before?
Skittles.
I love it. Skittles.
Yeah. You know what? You want to know why I use Skittles?
The peanut butter, probably, right? No, that's the rainbow flavor.
I use Skittles because I was catching catfish, and I thought that I would not catch a damn catfish on a Skittle. Well, I was wrong.
Wow. Do you
catfish ate the Skittles too?
Do you ever use any PVA bags?
I'd have. But I mean, really, our carp aren't that hard to catch, so I always travel light. You know, whatever I can carry. I don't want to have more than one trip to the car. I just keep it simple. My fishing's simple, you know? Just everything is just simple. I want to be able to get off work, pick up my stuff, and go fishing.
All right, you guys, we got a winner.
Yeah. Wait a minute.
Yeah, I just let him put some more on there just to keep him going. But if you guys go back up, it's RJ Grinder.
Oh, I see him. Yep.
333. Oh, I'm sorry.
No.
No, it ain't.
What the heck? You only have one job. Nope.
It's not it.
Sorry. I'm looking at it right now.
Yeah.
He's right.
I got it written right here, but I'm still looking for it. Go.
Oh, my God. How embarrassing. Lord.
I thought that was it.
I'm embarrassed right now. I'm embarrassed, Tommy.
Oh, you'll be all right.
That's how it is for me at work.
Hey, bro, I'm only human.
Man.
So it's still going on.
Sorry,
he was,
RJ.
I'm going to say he was close. So there it is right there.
They think. Who is it?
Josh Mason.
Oh, Josh, yep.
Josh Mason. It was 3:30.
You better take it to the camera so they can see it.
Yeah, the threes got it.
Take it right straight to the video camera and show them that number.
It was 3:30.
Can they see it?
That's a 777 is an 01.
Yeah.
But it was 3:30.
Wow. Sorry, RJ. Congratulations. Who was it?
Josh Mason.
Josh Mason.
Get a hold of myself or James Sanders. Yeah, if you're local, we'll get it to you.
Wow.
Sorry, everybody. I'm only human. I only have one job. I don't know why. I got sidetracked. Well, I guess the threes. Everybody, oh, that's funny. You guys, that's funny.
We're all going to live. We'll be okay.
Yeah, I know.
I'm not going to lose sleep tonight. I'm not.
He's in Richmond.
Oh, is he?
Yeah, so that means you got to drive out the highway. Drop that bag off.
I'll just drop it off. Hey, Josh. Josh here. Josh. It's tournament blend, Josh. Congratulations, Josh. Thanks for winning. Yeah, just send me your address. I'll send it to you. So.
It's okay. James Sanders, Tommy Pearson didn't finish kindergarten.
Yeah, we did, for real, seriously, it's a true story. But
I was in a screech.
Was you in a screech?
No. Not at that age.
But no
problem, Josh. Congratulations on winning.
Man.
My bad, RJ.
Yeah.
I'm gonna buy you.
You gonna buy it?
I'm gonna give you a bag too, RJ. Just for me messing up.
There you go. Did you? So your address, RJ. Look at you.
Thanks, Kenny. Appreciate you, brother, man. Same to you.
Kenny Mack. Oh, my God.
I couldn't have went down there with a better gentleman. You know, that's
right. Even me?
I mean, you were supposed to go, man. You know, you left me hanging. Kenny had to pick up your slack, man.
I did.
Nah, he didn't leave me hanging. You know, family. You know, it's just he just couldn't make it.
That's good.
Not the right time. But I couldn't ask to go down there with a better gentleman, man.
Yeah.
We had a blast. We had a great time. We had a few drinks. Man, we just had a blast.
You drink?
Huh? Yeah. Like when we would stop and you know get food, we would have you know I had a Jack and Coke with my dinner.
Okay. All right. I didn't think you drink.
No, I don't. Not like that.
Yeah, gotcha.
Occasions, you know. But I would definitely, you know, hopefully I get to come down and share the bank with you in Del Hollow, man. That's what I look forward to. A little 2-day getaway or something.
Yeah, definitely.
I'd love it if I could bring my wife and the old lady. That'd be make it even better.
That two women?
Huh?
Is that two women?
Wife and the baby.
Wife and old lady?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wife and the baby.
Oh, the baby.
Yeah.
I thought you said old lady.
No.
Wife and the old lady.
I meant to say wife and the baby. If I did, wife and we'll have to go back and watch the replay. But because. Yeah, my wife and the side chick, James.
Oh, I love talking to you guys. I love it. Good time.
Yeah.
Do you have like a group of carp anglers, like a carp anglers group over there in Ohio that you?
We definitely have a good following of carp guys.
Yeah.
It's kind of like north and south, down south, southern Ohio. They have a pretty good following up here where I run my tournaments and whatnot. I've got about 20 guys that are pretty. They love it just as much as the rest of us.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and we all, kind of spread the
hard
you know,
call
whatever carp. love we can, whenever we're on the bank. So it definitely does get more and more newbies every year. So it's definitely growing. My tournaments aren't bad. That kind of reflects how things are going. But people get, involved with, their kids and whatnot, so fishing sometimes isn't their first priority.
Right, right.
I have a very good question for Richie. I don't think Kenny was on here when Richie said something about... Richie hosts a tournament every month.
That's
it. The last Saturday
of the month.
The last Saturday of the month. Because Kenny said, how could a guy go fishing with Richie?
Oh.
So, you know, maybe you can get a hold of Kenny Mack too, man. And go, you know, he does the houseboat.
Kenny reached out to me before, I definitely would love to, you know, share the bank with them.
Yeah, man, we had a good time.
Yeah.
You definitely have a blast with him, man. He really, really down to earth guy.
Yeah.
Well, I want to get him up here. I know Dale Hollow is a great place,
but I am
hooked on Lake Erie.
Yeah, it has everything
to
offer.
The challenges up there are off the charts. So I want to get him up on Lake Erie. That's what I want to do with Kenny.
Nice.
Is that where you host your tournaments at?
I have them, and just every month I just kind of, you know, say, hey, where do we want to fish at? So I kind of let the guys tell me where they want to fish at.
Okay, that's cool.
We don't really have them too much up on Lake Erie because it's unpredictable. You have it scheduled, but if the wind's blowing the wrong way, it's not going to work.
Kenny Mack said, say when, Richie. He said, well, he didn't say I, he said dare ya.
Oh, there you go.
I tell you, it's a difficult.
He called you out, man.
When you start fishing that big of a water, your carp fishing, your game changes.
Yeah. Oh,
called you out.
Yeah, because you definitely want to aim for the
same. I double dog dare you.
In fact, I'm sitting in my truck right now, so.
Yeah. So Bay Hollow would be all right, but you know, I get him up on Lake Erie.
Yeah, yeah. We could dig it.
He said, in fact, I'm sitting in my truck right now, so.
He's on his way there.
So he's on his way.
Your address is what?
By the time he gets here, maybe we'll be fishing on Saturday or Sunday.
Yeah.
But dress warm, because it's going to be like 30 degrees.
Yeah, fish still bite good there in that time?
They stack up in the wintertime. I mean, wintertime fishing is honestly super easy. If you just figure out where they're at, they're all just stacked up. It's like, I mean, one after another.
Nice little hole in that little section that you know, if you know the spot?
No, it's not. It's normally not a little section. They'll group up into 1,000 fish up on Lake Erie.
That's kind of sweet, dude. That is
just
really
a
sweet.
Big old mass of fish.
Now, what about fish burying themselves? What do you know about that, Rich?
Okay, now look, that's a good question right there.
Good job, bro.
The only place I've not caught a carp on the ice is on a lake. Now, I've watched carp bury themselves in lily pads, like where they would normally like feed on,
a lot of muck,
crayfish, whatnot, like that. You know, your lily pads is the muck. It's black. It will hold heat longer than like a sand. So I've seen carp in a lake bury themselves to the point where they hibernate, to where they don't move much at all. So my biggest goal is to try to catch them out of the lake. I've seen them been caught out of the lake, you know. But there are different types of lakes than we have here. We have muck on the bottom.
Mm.
Like lily pads and whatnot. So I think that it's definitely possible, but I don't use cameras and stuff.
Yeah.
So I think that if I wanted to catch them on a lake, I would really have to find where they're all stacked up burying themselves for the winter and not really moving around a lot.
Do you...
So that's a goal of mine.
We was just talking about the ice fishing for carp and all that kind of stuff. At a spot that you go to fish a lot, ice fishing.
Excuse me.
How deep is that spot?
Well, that's a good question too, because I've caught carp in 3 foot of water underneath the ice.
Oh, I can believe that.
And I've caught them, like the other spots that I go to, I've caught them in 10, 12 foot of ice.
Yeah.
You know, of water. So these are still just river fish that are coming off of a river going into a backwater fluid that freezes up.
Thank you, Kenny. He said bless you.
Yeah, my man. Right?
So I'm taking it when you say you're ice fishing on top of a river.
Right.
So now, do you have a large stream that underneath?
There's definitely
a good current
where you can tell where the river runs through and the ice is thinner, where it doesn't get as thick. You can
Okay.
So you just got to stay out of the channel.
Okay. All right. Have you ever thought about taking a GoPro and just kind of like throw a GoPro? Pro right down there on ice where you ice fish and just
off the problem is the fish don't they don't really give a crap what we want to do,
right?
So like this last little bit, it was all nighttime.
Okay.
And I had one day where it was I could fish during the day where I caught them, but I already dragged a whole bunch of other crap out on the ice. So it becomes complicated whenever you're ice fishing.
Stay consistent, RJ. Stay consistent and don't use a bunch of different stuff.
Right, plus I can look down in the hole if I want to.
RJ.
If I want to see him, I can look down in the hole.
Right, okay, I dig it. But sometimes you watch a lot of these, these other carp angler videos, like, oh my gosh, a lot of people from Europe.
The UK.
Like Nash and, UK videos where they're actually, what's that guy with the glasses?
Paul Hunt?
No, the UK YouTubers.
Right, yeah.
I forget.
If I wasn't poor, I'd probably do go that route.
Yeah. But
I'm good enough with just, doing what I do.
Yeah. I mean, they use GoPros down in the water and video cameras.
Right. I just don't have all that.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, it is this. I think it was kind of fascinating. I would love to get a lot of underwater scenes. Yeah, Rafael is going to be on our guest next week.
He said, shh, don't say nothing.
Oh, it's too late, sorry.
No. But Kenny Mack was saying it's a secret move that he was doing to get a run down there, and it was pretty much working. But you know what? I don't know if it's going to show it on that video. I don't know if I got it on camera or not, but when them scientists do, we had just got there that morning.
Yeah.
And another fisherman that was there had called Austin, was like, hey, these scientists dude, the fishing wildlife guys was here. I told them that you was here, so I sent them over to you because they was like, he's here. So they came over and talked to him or whatever, and we hadn't caught any fish yet morning.
Until you got the run.
Well, as soon as they got there and we started talking, boom, we started getting
fish. I got that.
Yeah,
that's
I got the next week when we're on here. I got the guy's card. He gave me his card. I'd like to get him on the show to talk about, what their plan is to do on trying to.
The whole scientist.
Because they're really really interested in trying to help and protect them carp. So yeah.
Okay,
it's gonna be fun.
I can dig it. Yeah, heck yeah.
But
that's a good video. You did some pretty good work there a little bit.
He said Raphael couldn't do it. Instead of linebacker move, I did a full body dip in freaking freezing water, then stayed on the bank wet for another 3 hours fishing hardcore stuff. LOL.
That's dedication.
Beer helped. Yeah, I bet you're sick now.
Yeah, that's dedication right there.
He friended me on Facebook.
He defriended?
He's talking to Raphael. Kenny Mack is.
But, Lord, we're on the phone with the Iceman, Richie Eldridge. My God.
It's been a pleasure, guys.
Yeah.
Always.
How many lakes do you usually, here's a better question. Do you have any problems with DNRs, or do you, educate DNRs or anything when it comes towards carp fishing?
No, they just want to kill carp.
So they just want to kill it.
it's nuts. I mean, carp's a bad word here.
Wow, isn't that crazy?
Yeah, it's a bad word here.
Man.
We got walleye, you know, and that kind of trumps everything. So everybody just is like walleye and perch, you know, just...
You know, I really feel like, except for the Asian carp, that everything is a circle of life with all the species, even with the common carp, because the bass, you know, they're eating the minnows of the well, carp, commons, and all that kind of stuff. And
this is how I describe the bottom feeder concept. Every fish is a bottom feeder because at some point in their life and throughout their life, they eat stuff off the bottom. A bass eats crayfish off the bottom.
Right.
They eat snails, they eat, you know, worms off the bottom. So they all eat shit off the bottom.
Exactly.
So they're all damn bottom feeders. All of them.
I feel like the United States is... the only country I feel like it's backwards when it comes to carp fishing, because carp fishing is all out through the entire world. You know what I mean? And
right.
I don't think everybody else is having problems with, you know, other countries are having problems with the carp, but when it comes to the United States, for some odd reason, you know.
We live in little glass houses.
Yeah, we're so far behind, it's unreal.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, and I said this before on this show before, you know, it's like, I feel like the United States is backwards because... I love football. Okay, that's fine. But when the number one sport in all the other countries is soccer. But of course, you know, the number one sport here in the United States is football, which is fine. And then, but it's also bass tournaments is probably the one number one sport of fish here in the United States. You know, and of course, I don't think it's that way in any other countries.
And they weren't native to our country.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
And I feel like like you said, DNRs, they favoritize the bass anglers more than they do the carp anglers.
It's just going to take the right people, to really just put some money behind it, you know. But it's people like Raphael, you know, coming to New York and doing the Wild Water Store and... you know, making stuff more available over here in the U.S. and stuff like that.
Exactly.
You know, people may not understand, but us just being here right now, talking about carp and people seeing this and, you know.
I do think 10 years ago.
Nobody was talking about carp like that.
Yeah, 10 or 15 years ago, nobody. But I feel like it's catching faster and faster.
Yeah, it is.
You know, now, but if we get more and more carp businesses going on, you know,
you're like, seeing it more.
Yeah,
more and more.
I would love to see big companies come over here and, you know, start making boilies and all that kind of stuff.
But all that stuff's already there's already people that's on.
There's a couple.
Joe Lutz, you know.
You got World Classic Bait.
Yeah,
you know,
and look at Proline.
Proline,
you know what I mean? Like those, those are some big heavy hitters that's in the game right now. That's going to continue to grow and be more than what it is. You know what I mean?
So,
Yeah. It's just, you know, it's, like I said, it's growing and growing, and it ain't going to do nothing but get bigger and bigger.
Yeah, so.
You know, I see
at least it's growing and not
decreasing. Yeah, because even in the pay.
How fast it's growing, it's growing.
I mean, we had that, I think they were in the talks of the carp Olympics here in the United States.
Yeah, like the world's.
Yeah, the world's, yeah. Did they have it?
Richie's met them.
Yeah.
Richie's fished against some of them.
Well, I'm talking about the...
I want to say you fished with one of them, mate. What, what's his name on there? Who'd you went fish with in New York?
My partner, Attila Ag.
Yep, Attila.
We fished with, for
he's on USA Carp Team.
Team USA.
Yeah, Team USA.
Yeah, I was about to say, he's fished up. I mean, when you go to New York and fish a tournament like that, it's a, you know, you're fishing against some of the best in the world, you know, that I guess just That's not, because you get people from Hungary and everything that come to them tournaments.
Yeah.
People come from far and far to fish some tournaments. Good turnouts, too.
Yeah.
You got any questions for us, Richie?
No, I'm just glad you guys are doing what you're doing. It's good stuff like this, and then just...
That's what I'm talking about, Richie. That's what I'm talking about. Thanks, brother.
Yeah, we appreciate that, man.
Yeah, we need that.
You know, we don't, you know, we're not the best...
You're taking time out of your day to do this. Because like for me, you know, earlier we had the time schedule from 7 o'clock, we moved it to 8. Well, that was a good thing because, you know, we all have lives and I didn't really think that I was going to have a hard time getting to do this at 7 o'clock, but work kept me a little bit longer.
Yeah. You know, so the rest we're of never the time, on time. We're never on time.
No. Yeah. And you guys don't believe this. James, he gets here about 7:30, 7:20 all the time.
Just trying to get set up.
And, you know, because he has to take the computer and, you know, we have to hook everything back up, you know, make sure
we
have power,
get
the lighting
and stuff. And,
you know, it's a lot that goes into this stuff, Dan, and we don't make no money from
doing
this.
Take my shots. I got to take my shots.
I got to make sure the baby's in, you know, make sure Amy's good with the baby in bed most of the time, you know, try to put her back.
Yeah.
I wish I could smoke on the show too.
Maybe we should.
We should smoke on the show. No, not that kind. What? Huh?
I just smoke a cigar.
You
want to
smoke a cigar?
Just
sit back and smoke cigars.
Right?
It's legal to smoke cigars in your neighborhood, ain't it?
Oh, yeah. we got that going on.
Yeah. Now is it medical there or recreational?
Cigars?
Yeah.
Recreational cigars.
Yeah. So do they have cigar shops up there now?
Not yet, but they do for anybody who has their recreational card.
Yeah.
But they've done already passed everything, so I think it's the waiting period, and then you'll be able to, you know, go and buy cigars.
Yeah. That'd be nice.
Well, you know, if you're going fishing, you got to catch something.
Yeah, for sure.
Catch something.
Yeah. Might as well stop and get you some cigars.
Well, there you go.
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
You know, what time is it?
I can't see what time. Yeah, what time you got, Richie?
10.
It's
10
o'clock.
10 o'clock? 10 o'clock? Mm-hmm. Oh, it's
time. Time flies when you're having fun.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
Well, we're coming in.
I was looking forward to this.
Yeah. Well, we too, man. Every year I get, I always look for your, you know, especially around winter time. Oh, Richie's going to do that carp. Get that going out of the ice.
I was glad to be able to get to go out and fish. Believe me, I was excited to go out and fish in 18 degree weather.
Man. Make sure you send James some pictures.
You know, I knew that I had to do it when I had to do it, and 18 degrees was just a factor.
Yeah. Make sure you send James some pictures.
Now it's going to probably be a little bit since to get this video on YouTube.
Yeah, I guess he's working on the buff video, right?
I'm working. I'm having a laptop problems. It's ran out of memory. I probably have to get a new laptop.
Done.
I have to go buy a new one.
That scientist video.
So yeah, I got your video. I got my video. I made a video
when you blanked the other day.
I blanked, but I made a good killer ass meal.
Yeah,
that looked like a good spot. Was you fishing?
Yeah,
that one with the waterfall.
Yeah,
with the little roll dam.
Yeah, it was before that.
Oh, you was above it.
Yeah, I was above the waterfall.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of our winter time spots are roll dams. You know.
I mean, I have caught carp from that spot. That just. I think I would have done a lot better if I just like chummed it the day before.
So I do have a question for you guys.
Yeah, let's do it. Come on, man. I love questions.
All right. Let's do it.
Come on.
Do you guys have what is going on with your waters right now? If you had to go fishing right now, where would you go?
Oh.
Like if you had to catch a carp, where would you go?
Well,
probably to the canal.
Yeah, the canal. There's a spot that...
I mean, Rick, White River too, but...
Well, there actually is a spot right by... it's a...
what's that? All right. You guys are... Rock you river. Guys, I hear you. But I want to ask another question since you guys don't have a straightforward answer so fast, right?
The rivers.
So for me, it's like a no-brainer. I know I can just, you know, like, there's a... Like, when's the last time you went fishing? That's what I'm saying. When's the last time you guys went fishing?
When's the last time?
I just got back from Texas, but as far as here,
yeah,
man, it was probably in January at Hubbard's at a Pay Lake.
Yeah.
Okay, Wild Water.
Texas. But as far as here, man, yeah. I don't know. It's been a while.
I think it's mine was
sometime last year.
Yeah, it's like a
you know our you know it we have to travel, you know.
Well,
I mean, mine was at Lake Sullivan.
You don't have any creeks? You don't have any creeks? Little like small bodies of water that have like carp in them?
I mean, we have a bunch of those, but you know, once you've hit 30s and
no,
you know, I mean, it's fun catching fish. There's nothing wrong with it, but you know, we don't. It's hard to get anything big like that in our waterways. They just don't hold big fish.
The point is just going out and
getting
your rod bent.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Exactly.
You know that. You know, just going out and getting your rod bent. That's all.
Right.
But as far as the ice fishing goes, for you know, like I was saying earlier, I fish like at least three days a week. You know, I'd like to fish like 5 days out of the week, 3 to 4 days a week. You know. So I want to catch carp when I'm going. So I do have places around me that are skinny waters. That's what I call them. They're not, but
guaranteed to catch a fish.
5 foot deep. There's you know just like they're running waters, like the roll dams where the you know the water is at least moving.
Yeah.
You know those fish never stop eating.
Yeah.
You know.
It seems like our waters just don't hold, you know.
There's a spot up there in Broad Ripple.
Yeah.
Like what Richie's talking about, it'll be a little commons, but you know, it's not too far where Kenny Mack lives at that spot.
We told him to see your spots.
Yeah. But it's a good winter spot. Last place I went to was up at Lake Sullivan, up in Rome City, and there's some good 30s.
That's
in that
where we
one.
Went. Didn't we go there?
Yeah, that's where.
That was the first video shoes of the year.
Yeah, that's the first time you. Yeah,
that's the first time I've been there.
The last time I went there, as me and my son did a little solo video shoot up there. I may have called about 3, I think.
Yeah,
but that you know. It wasn't really a big, big size. I mean, it was close to the 20s almost.
Uh-huh.
But
close to the 20s, probably like 10, 11.
No, man. You always put it down, dude. Man, I lose sleep sometimes over that mess. I do. I toss and turn. Yeah, it's like, get out of bed.
Yeah, dang.
It's Tommy. He started it, man. He says I can't catch a fish. I got to pay for my fish.
You know, James has been proving himself.
That's right.
He has been known here lately to be caught catching fish.
Let me tell you about my medallion.
On video.
Let me tell you about my medallion.
Yeah, I don't even want to touch that medallion. I can just imagine what you've been doing with you and your medallion.
All that nasty stuff I did to that medallion. Oh.
No, all that nasty stuff you did while you was wearing your medallion.
Take showers, lather. Okay, fair enough. But
I think we're getting towards the end of the show.
We are getting to it. Man, Rich, it was awesome talking to you, brother.
Oh, I can talk to you guys all night.
Yeah.
We'll have to get you back on the show soon, man. I'd like to come out there,
do some bank fishing with you,
and fish that tournament.
Oh, man, guys, I'm telling you, Lake Erie. Just hit me up.
Okay.
We should try to. We should put that on. Try to make a video shoot out of that.
Well, we already got our video shoot though.
Yeah, but we should try to prior. You know what I mean? Like that'd be a good place to go.
How you How's it during the summertime with you?
When's the best time to come down there and really fish Lake Erie? Let's put it like that.
Anytime.
Yeah.
When's the best time though? Like, you know, to get
you
know, the...
I think if you wanted to pick, you know, like a time where you're going to get on the bigger fish, their spawn is a little bit different in the harbors.
Yeah.
Because you got fish that spawn back in the backwaters, and you got fish that spawn in the harbors. The bigger fish spawn in the harbors. That's where your clear water is. That's where you're going to catch your bigger fish in Lake Erie. Which they're very, very spooky fish because it's clear water.
Mm.
But I would say late June.
June, really?
Because the water takes a long time to warm up.
Up north.
You know, as far as getting a good temperature for them. So it's late June,
mm-hmm.
probably for good big fish.
Okay, good.
Honestly, right now, if you want a big fish out of Lake Erie, it's right now. It's winter time.
Wow,
because they haven't been eating everything inside.
They're piled up. They're piled up into the big masses, to where you get your big fish in the winter time.
Okay, sweet. Well, brother, I think we're at our end of our time, man.
And we appreciate you being on the show. We look forward to having you back on again. Yeah.
Definitely want to call you up again. You know, just...
We'll have to get together, Shannon, and do that. We'll plan a trip to go down there on one of his
tournaments. Richie, again, if you miss me at any time, you call me up any time, man. It's, hey, do you want me to...
I want to stop in on the show tonight.
Yeah, or something, you know, or say, hey, James, I miss you, brother. And
awesome. Yeah, appreciate the love, guys.
Yeah, definitely.
No, we appreciate you, and we will definitely talk to you soon.
Yes, sir. All right, brother. Thanks for watching. Well, thank you for being on the show.
You know, God bless.
Yep, you too.
Bye, brother. Wow, Richie. Man.
The Iceman. It's always good talking to him, man. He's awesome. a good carp angler. People can really, really learn a lot from him.
Heck yeah.
Share this live video. Like I said, we're getting close to the end of the show. Appreciate all the bait shops. Naptown Bait and Tackle, Bistro Bait and Tackle, Indie Bait and Tackle, The Bobber Shop. We appreciate our main sponsor, Big Money Beepers.
Big Money Beepers.
Always helping us out, having our back.
Bottom Feeder Baits.
Yep. Always appreciate James and Bottom Feeder Baits, you know, for keeping a good product and keeping it going, man. I've had an honor of, I can look back one day whenever your boy has Bottom Feeder Baits and say, me and Jeremy Verdine was first two pro staff for Bottom Feeder Baits.
That's right, yeah. West Side Baits.
Yep. Jim,
I'm gonna probably sell Bottom Feeder Baits here soon.
Yeah. Why?
Jeez.
What? You guys hear that? Bottom Feeder Baits might be for sale. Mm-hmm. They want that carp cocaine mix.
Yeah.
They want to buy that and they'll be good.
Spend time with family more.
Yeah.
Yeah, who knows?
Set it in the garage mixing up baits.
Yeah.
But nah, man, we appreciate you guys, man, and always practice carp care. You know, that we're big on that. Mm-hmm. Like you said, shout out to all the bait shops and shout out to Chris at the barber shop. He helps us out a lot too.
And our next guest next Wednesday is going to be Raphael from carpangler.com.
Yeah, man, so he just came back from Texas. We'll be talking about that. We'll probably go ahead and call Austin too.
Yeah,
maybe. And let Austin chime in on maybe his trip and how that went.
Why would you do that? Get the two-way call thing?
Huh?
Do a two-way call?
Yeah, why not?
Let's see what happens.
It'd be good to get them both on or let them, you know.
A few things.
Yep, just something to do. Just to, you know, do something different.
Hi. I'll bring a cigar next time, man.
Me too.
Hey, I'm gonna bring a cigar. Is that okay, I smoke down here?
Man, I don't know.
That's what I'm thinking.
I'll have to ask the wife.
No, never mind.
I have to ask the wife.
No, it's too much smoke. That does. Yeah. All right, guys. Thanks for watching our show.
Yeah, we appreciate you guys so much. Tight lines, a wet net.
Later.
We'll see you later, alligator.